In this segment, we will talk about how we can write higher order ordinary differential equations in the state variable form. We'll do this through an example. What we mean by writing the state variable form is as follows. Since all the numerical methods which we have talked about so far as solving ordinary differential equations are concerned, they are based on solving first order ordinary differential equations. If that is the case, as we have done by Euler's method or Runge-Kutta second order method or Runge-Kutta fourth order method, we now want to be able to see that if somebody gives us higher order ordinary differential equations, which is, let's suppose, a second order differential equation, how can we rewrite it as coupled first order ordinary differential equations so that we can continue to use the methods which we have learned for solving initial value problems through methods such as Euler's method. So here is a problem statement. Somebody is giving you this third order ordinary differential equation, and what they want you to do is to write it in state variable form. So how do we go about writing this differential equation statement? First thing which we're going to do is we're going to rewrite this with the different symbol, where we're going to use dots to show derivatives. So for example, first derivative is y dot, second derivative is y double dot, and third derivative is y triple dot. The reason why we are doing this is because this is the general way of writing these equations when we are trying to put them in the state variable form. So I'm basically following what is the convention which is generally used in most of the books, so that when you go to other courses such as vibrations or controls, you'll be familiar with this particular symbol, I suppose. So once we have seen this is a second derivative term, so we know these are not first derivative terms, so we have somehow have to do some transformation so that we can write it as a bunch of first order ordinary differential equations. So let's do it the simple way. What we can do is we can call y to be x1. So I am renaming y to be x1, which is the dependent variable, by another dependent variable called x1, for example. Then I'm going to say x2 is equal to y dot. First derivative of y is x2. But what is y dot? Y dot is nothing but x1 dot. Right from here. Then I'm going to write x3 as y double dot. And that y double dot is nothing but x2 dot. So because what we want to be able to do is we want to be able to write it in just in terms of the first derivative terms. So x1 is y, so x2 is x1 dot, and x3 is x2 dot. And now we don't need to go any further because we have this ordinary differential equation which we're going to use to be able to write down our next equation. So if you look at this original equation which is given to us, I can write as 17, y triple dot will be x3 dot. Because y double dot is x3, so y triple dot will be x3 dot. 3y double dot is nothing but x3. And y dot is 2. And then we have 5y, which is x1. And that's equal to 11 e to the power minus t. So we have basically written in terms of these three new variables which we have introduced, x1, x2, and x3. These are the dependent variables which we have introduced. But now we can see that, hey, this particular differential equation has only the first derivative term. So basically what happens is that this becomes your first ordinary differential equation. This becomes your second ordinary differential equation, your third ordinary differential equation. All of these three ordinary differential equations are in the first order form. So let's go and rewrite these three equations. We'll say that x1 dot is equal to x2. That's my first equation. And what I'll do is I'll write it as like this. I'll write it as 0x1 plus 1x2 plus 0x3. The reason why I'm doing this is because I want to be able to later on write this in the matrix form, so you will know where your zeros and ones should be in place. The next one will be x2 dot will be equal to x3, and I can write it as 0 times x1 plus 0 times x2 plus 1 times x3, while as now the third equation is going to come from here. And x3 dot will be equal to 11 e to the power minus t minus 3x3 minus 7x2 minus 5x1 divided by 17. So you see this, what we have done, we have basically written our first three ordinary differential equations, where all we have on the left side is the first derivative of the three dependent variables which we introduced to solve this particular problem. Now it's going to be very easy to write this in the state variable form. So what we're going to do is we're going to simplify this equation a little bit further. So this is our first equation, this is our second equation, and this is our third equation. Let's simplify this third equation a little bit more. So what we have is that we have x3 dot is equal to minus 5 divided by 17 x1 minus 7 divided by 17 x2 minus 3 by 17 x3 plus 11 e to the power minus t divided by 17. Now you can see that, hey, we can write down these equations in the state variable form. So what does that mean? This is extremely important that there's a one-to-one correspondence in order to be able to write this in the state variable form. So our state variables are x1, x2, and x3. Those go right here. So here we'll need a 3x3 matrix in order to be able to populate that, and here will be a 3x1 matrix, of course, because 3x1 matrix here. So what here will be the corresponding derivative terms, so will be x1 dot, x2 dot, x3 dot, and we'll get 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, and then here we'll have minus 5 divided by 17, because that is the x1 coefficient, minus 7 by 17 here, and minus 3 divided by 17 here. What goes here are the forcing terms. We have no forcing term in the first equation, no forcing term in the second equation, but we do have 11 e to the power minus t divided by 17, which is this term right here as a forcing term, and that goes in a separate place. And that's what your state variable form is for these differential equations, but it won't be complete without you writing what the initial conditions are. So if you look at the initial conditions which were given to us, those need to be again given in the same order as our state variable form. So if we have x1, x2, x3 here, the initial conditions have to be given on x1, x2, and x3 at some starting point. This we know is nothing but y of 0, y dot of 0, y double dot of 0, and this one here will turn out to be 13, because that's the initial value of y. The initial value of y dot is 19, the initial value of y double dot is 23. And that's how we write it in the state variable form. And if you have a program such as MATLAB, what you'll be doing is that you will be giving it the state variable matrix right here, this one right here to it. You will be providing it the forcing matrix. And also you'll be providing it the initial conditions. So once you have those three in place, you'll be able to find the solution. And that is the end of this segment.